but sure.
Okay, all right, thanks.
My pleasure.
Good, how are you?
Welcome to Morehouse College and historic Sale Hall Auditorium. My name is Greg Hall, and I'm the chair of the Department of Political Science and Director of International Studies here at Morehouse College. We're very pleased this evening to provide a venue and work with Common Cause Georgia to host this event. As we know, everyone is abuzz in the community about new stadium for the Falcons, and we are grateful, honored to be a part of this community discussion. William Perry is the executive director of Common Cause Georgia. He's an Atlanta native and former staff member of the Secretary of State and U.S. Senator Max Cleveland. He has worked as a neighborhood leader in Southeast Atlanta, worked in the Georgia office of the League of Conservation Voters, lobbied the Georgia Public Service Commission on local telephone service deregulation, and recently served as an alumni fundraiser for the University of Georgia. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, welcome Mr. William Perry.
Thank you, Dr. Hall, and thank you all for being here tonight. We're very pleased to be able to host this forum for you. Again, my name is William Perry. I'm the Executive Director of Common Cause Georgia, and as you might have seen in the materials that we've distributed, Common Cause Georgia is not taking a pro or con stance on should the new stadium be built. But we did want to engage the public further in this process and make sure that no matter what your position is on the issue, that it's heard by the decision makers. So we wanted to hold this forum and are pleased that some of those are here with us tonight, but we wanted to provide both an opportunity to educate you on the issues as well as get your questions answered, if at all possible. I first want to recognize, I know we've got a couple of public officials here, Council Member Ivory Lee Young from the Atlanta City Council, who has kind of the direct interest in the issue because the stadium is called the Rams within his district, and also Council Member Felicia Moore, who is also in a very nearby district. And I didn't get to do my meet and greet at the front door, so do I have any other public officials that are here that I may have missed? Is that Senator Vincent Ford?
Yes, it is.
All right. The lights are bright. So Senator Vincent Ford, thank you for being here.
Can you hear me?
Oh, yes. And maybe we can is there anybody else that I missed? All right, thank you very much. Before we get to our panel, I just wanted to tell you kind of the run of our show here. We're going to first introduce the panelists as well as our moderator. Each panelist will start off with about a 6 to 8 minute opening or just any information that they would like to share with you. At that point, the moderator will take the moderator's liberty to perhaps ask them a few questions or maybe turn it over at that point to our audience questioning. Because we've had a lot of interest on these issues, we wanted to make sure that we used the time as wisely as we could. So we got these comment cards as well as hopefully pencils at all the locations. We'll continue to distribute those. But if you have a question, please fill that out. And myself or Ryan Splitlog, who's the assistant director at Common Cause Georgia, will be making the rounds and collecting those and getting those questions answered. Obviously, we're probably not going to be able to get to all of them tonight, but we wanted to collect them in this fashion so that we could then put them in a document, provide them to the panelists, and if they have the ability and the time to respond, then we'll make sure that we send them out to anybody that's on our email list. And hopefully get as many questions answered as we possibly can. So that gives us kind of the ground rules, and we hope that will satisfy you, but Ryan and I will be moving around as much as possible to get that done. I'll go ahead now and introduce our panelists. We start off, and being a big University of Georgia fan, it gives me great pleasure to show that Georgia Tech and Georgia guys can work together in situations when needed, especially on issues that aren't the football field when it comes to the stadium. But Dr. Benjamin Flowers is an associate professor at Georgia Tech, where he joined the faculty there in architecture in 2005. In 2010, he was awarded the outstanding academic title in architecture by Choice Magazine. In 2008, the Outstanding Teacher Award from the College of Architecture. He's the editor of a forthcoming publication, Architecture in an Age of Uncertainty, which I think will help apply to where we are now. His first book, Skyscraper, The Politics and Power of Building New York City in the 20th Century, was printed in 2009. Also another recent publication, Stadium Architecture, Visual Iconography, and the Shaping of Urban and Sporting Identities. And hopefully he'll be able to explain to a UGA guy like me exactly what that means. But it sounds extremely interesting. And also, Stadia Architecture and the Visual Iconography of Football. So that also intrigues me quite a bit. So Dr. Flowers received his PhD from the University of Minnesota and a BA from Wesleyan University in Middletown, Connecticut. So if you will please welcome Dr. Benjamin Flowers. Next is Mr. Wyc Orr. Despite his Auburn education, he is a quite studious gentleman. He's been a trial lawyer for almost 40 years, having argued cases in state, federal trial, and appellate courts across Georgia, and in court martial cases as a prosecutor. He's currently the senior partner of Orr, Brown, Johnson, which is a trial lawyer firm with offices in Gainesville, Athens, Atlanta, and Jefferson. So you drive around North Georgia a little bit, I guess. And those cases involving serious personal injury, wrongful death, commercial and business disputes, and employment litigation. So he runs the whole table there. Mr. Orr represented Hall and Dawson counties and a portion of Gwinnett in the Georgia House of Representatives from 1989 to 1993. Interestingly enough, when the Georgia Dome was being debated and discussed and voted on in the Georgia legislature. He's also one of the newest members of Common Cause Georgia. And so we thank him for his participation and his service to our organization. So we'd like to interview and welcome Mr. Wyc Orr. And last but not least on the panel, Mr. Frank Poe, who is the Executive Director of the Georgia World Congress Center. Mr. Poe started his career with the Dallas Convention Center, starting off as a part-time laborer, and then ended up moving on to lead that group, working there for 17 years in several leadership positions at the center's event services and cultural affairs departments. He came to the Georgia World Congress Center with 38 years experience in the convention industry. He's also served as the director of Alabama Birmingham Jefferson Convention Center in 1997 till 2004, when he went back to Dallas to assume the head position there. He also, as head of the Dallas Convention Center, had physical control of an annual budget of more than $60 million, is that correct? That's amazing. And responsible for the management of the Dallas Convention Center, the Reunion Arena, Dallas Farmers Market, Union Station, and the Office of Special Events. So needless to say, you were a little bit busy. So I want to thank him especially for coming tonight, because I think oftentimes when a group steps forward to question a process or to say that we need to shed more light, that is seen as a negative, and we haven't wanted it to come across that way. We know that it has. So we really want to thank Mr. Poe for joining us and for doing that, and assure him that we're looking forward to a very productive event and not one we're looking to be negative or anything like that. So with that, if you'll welcome Mr. Frank Poe. And then, our MC of events. I have to tell you, I had to do a little research and just kind of wanted to start off with just a few of DeMarco Morgan's accomplishments. So let me quickly read them out. And I joke, but it's incredible seeing his resume. He just came here in January to join as a co-anchor 11 Alive News. He came from us to New York, where he's also had tours of duty in Miami, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and started his broadcast career where he went to school in Jackson, Mississippi, at Jackson State University, and he also received a master's degree from Columbia University. He's an extremely strong advocate of community service, which is one of the things that caught our eye for wanting him to be involved with this particular event. When you're the head of a nonprofit, when you see somebody's community resume, you know how hard they work, how dedicated they are to their mission. And so just to give you some of the ideas that he's done, he's volunteered with Big Brothers and Big Sisters of America, 100 Black Men of Atlanta, the American Cancer Society, the Bachmann-Strauss Foundation, Sharp Literacy Incorporated. He has been on the board of managers for the YMCA. It says he's a proud member of Kappa Alpha Psi fraternity. He received in 2006 the NABJ National Community Service Award. in Milwaukee, where he worked. He was an honorary Grand Marshal in 2 years in a row for the United Negro College Fund. He served as spokesperson for the Thurgood Marshall College Fund based in New York. While a student at Columbia, he even helped start their journalism school student chapter of the National Association of Black Journalists. He also taught journalism at Jacksonville State University for 2 years, and I've taught English at Milwaukee Area Technical Institute. So you're not one to sit still very long, are you? He was also named one of the only African-Americans ranked in the nation's top 10 collegiate journalists in the country in 2001 by Scripps Howard, and named one of Ebony Magazine's top 30 future young leaders of America in 2006. He was named one of South Florida Magazine's top 40 most influential black journalists in 2008, and in 2009 he presented the Thurgood Marshall Prestige Award for his community service in New York as well as across the country. So now you can see what I talked about with that resume. So without further ado, to get our program started, I'm going to turn it over to DeMarco Morgan of 11 Alive News.
A wise man once said that your true character is revealed by the clarity of your convictions, the choices you make, and the promises you keep. You have to hold strongly to your principles and refuse to follow the currents of convenience. For what you say and do defines who you are, and who you are, you are forever. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We can do better than that. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, this is a public forum here, so we want to hear some talking and talking back to us. Of course, we want to give our panelists right here a round of applause just for coming out. Also, a special thanks to this organization and also Morehouse, the house, for allowing us to come here. Let's give Morehouse a round of applause. This opportunity, and I gotta hang on to that. That was pretty cool. Thank you so much. God has been extremely good to me, and it's always good to give back and take part in these discussions whenever it's educating our community about something that is so near and dear to all of us. So we've been talking about the stadium since I've been here for the past 11 months in New York City. The Jets and the Giants, the Mets and the Yankees got new stadiums. So I've heard both sides of the argument for years and for years now. So it was no strange when I came to Atlanta, Georgia, to find out that there are some who want the stadium, there are some who do not want the stadium. But we're going to hear from you. I'm not going to do most of the talking. I get upset when I go to these forums and the moderator does all the talking. We don't hear from the people. So it is your chance to voice your concerns and to ask your questions. But before we start tonight, I want to start with the Dr. Benjamin Flowers. If you could go ahead and give us your statement. 6 to 8 minutes. Let's see if you can do it.
I can. Can everyone hear me?
No. You know what I think? You know what? Let me fast.
Station mic.
Can everyone hear me now?
Okay. Yes.
All right. Let me start by saying I've been researching Stadia for almost a decade. So I come to this discussion as a fan of the building type, generally. Which is to say, I spend a lot of time on vacation making my family go with me to visit stadiums. They don't understand why I do this. I keep saying these are really interesting structures. They say, no, it's just a field and some seats. I say, no, it's actually more than that. Now that said, what I think the question could be in this discussion, but hasn't been, is that it seems certain that the pro-growth coalition behind the stadium is moving towards concluding a deal that will see a new stadium approved sooner rather than later. That's my personal opinion. I'm not a political scientist, but I've lived in Atlanta since 2005, and I see things moving in a certain direction. What I find discouraging is that, given that potential political reality, there's been discussion primarily of two kinds. One, should the stadium be built, or B, should it not? I think the bigger question that's being left out is that, given that a new stadium will be a public-private partnership, one question we might begin to more robustly interrogate is, what does the public get in return for its investment in a new stadium? And I would argue that that question needs to be decided in a very particular fashion, which is to say, the communities of English Avenue and Vine City and adjacent neighborhoods have borne the brunt of the Georgia Dome and its positive and negative impacts. One question I think has not been more robustly addressed that we could begin to discuss today is, how and what ways could a new stadium begin to provide things to the adjacent community that it currently does not have, but wants. And how and what fashion are public dollars, no matter where they come from, it doesn't matter where these dollars are raised, they are still public dollars when they are spent, which means they are dollars being spent on the stadium that are not being spent on other services and goods that cities need and want. How and in what way could that $300 million be leveraged meaningfully with the public as a negotiating partner to provide to the adjacent neighborhoods in the city of Atlanta things, goods, services, functions that it actually wants? Even under the most ambitious scheduling, a stadium is occupied for no more than 8 to 10 home games, and then whatever adjacent games can be scheduled. We're talking perhaps even under the most robust imagination, 100 nights of the year. What could we do with $1 billion of infrastructure that was actually activated for the remaining 265 days of the year, rather than just the 100 in which there is a game or an event of some kind? I think there are very creative people in this city. I think the people at the GWCC, I think Arthur Blank, I think the Falcons, I think the city of Atlanta has a lot of smart people with creative ideas, and yet I'm not hearing a lot of discussion about how something of this nature, of $1 billion of infrastructure, all told, could do something more than host sporting events. That's, to my mind, a pragmatic, albeit not idealistic, approach to responding to these kind of questions. That's one that I think might actually generate some long-term benefits for the community that have been promised in the past, benefits from stadium construction, spillover effects in terms of jobs and economic development, that don't always appear. So I think these are important questions for us to consider.
Mr. Orr.
Thank you very much, and again, let me thank the others and thank all of you for being here tonight, because this is about public participation. So if the public does not attend, then that participation is not assisted. Also, on behalf of Common College of Georgia, I want to thank Mr. Poe so much for being here tonight. What a positive statement that is about the authority believing in the openness of the process, being answerable to the public. So we're very pleased that he agreed to be here tonight. And in conjunction with that, I think we should note at the outset that we do not see Common College of Georgia's role here. Not only, as William said, do we not have any position pro or con on the stadium itself, but rather Common College of Georgia exists to stand for and to advocate for and to facilitate open government, ethical government, accountable government. That is the interest of Common College of Georgia, and we think that aligns completely with the interest of the public in this matter. So it should be noted that we not only don't take a position on the stadium itself, but we appreciate very much the War Congress Center Authority. I was talking to Mr. Pope ahead of time about his predecessor, Dan Greatman, who did such a marvelous job for so many years, as Mr. Pope is indeed following in those same tracks. The Falcons, I think it's fair to say that we're all Falcon fans, and their record of 10-1 on the field right now speaks for the excellence of that organization. So this is not about the people involved. This is about the process, and our wanting to see that process as open as possible. Glad to see Abel Mabel here. I served with Mabel in the House some 20 years ago, so great to see her again and all the other public officials, Senator Fort and the council members. Thank you all for being here. Now, with respect to the process itself, which we are most concerned, and that's why Common Cause Georgia has involved itself and has convened this public forum tonight. When I said that we believe in the crucial importance of open government and accountable government, that is directly involved in the process here in question. We are interested in, I know you are, and you will have your questions, we are interested in how far along the negotiations are. As we understand it, the negotiations are occurring between, or principally between, two negotiating parties, and that's the World Congress Center Authority and the Atlanta Falcons. We think that it's a legitimate concern that all other affected public entities be involved also. For example, we have heard it said from the city itself that what infrastructure costs it will have to bear may not be known until a deal may have been struck. And so with the full outlines of the stadium proposal and indeed the deal itself has been finalized, only then perhaps may the city know the full extent of what its costs may be, what infrastructure burdens it will have to bear, and the like. We think that's a matter of legitimate public concern. What other governmental entities will be affected by this? Appreciating the fact that the World Congress Center Authority is a state-created authority, to what extent will the state of Georgia have to bear any cost, Fulton County have to bear any cost? To what extent are those public entities fully apprised of this, and what input will they have prior to the deal being done so that they and their constituents can know precisely what those costs will be and how will they be paid? Those are critical details that we think should be known in advance. There are many other aspects of this that we at Common Cause Georgia feel should be known before a deal is agreed upon and finalized. For example, we know that apparently some consideration has been given to whether or not the existing stadium can be renovated in any way. We understand that possible approach has been jettisoned. Has sufficient consideration been given to that in the public interest and with an eye toward costs. And alluding to what was said a moment before, what other uses can be made of the stadium in the 300 plus days per year? And we appreciate the fact that it won't just be about Falcons football, it'll be about SEC tournaments and all championship games and a variety of other events. But what other events and uses can be given to this stadium, and is that being adequately considered in the process? We know, for example, that there's a substantial homeless problem in the city of Atlanta. Is there anything about the design of the stadium that might allow it to be utilized, particularly in the cold months, to provide shelter for individuals who otherwise are on the streets and cold and in danger of freezing to death, whatever the case may be? That's just one example of the kinds of things that we think that the public often has in mind and can share and can provide input into a process if the public is included and brought into the negotiations and brought into all of the factors for consideration before the deal is final. Other aspects, what are the what hidden costs might there be? Not only infrastructure costs, will there be any tax concessions? We have had the opportunity to see what we understand to be one of the latest drafts of a term sheet, which has many to be determined in it, but it has a variety of provisions in it that we think the public should have access to before it goes further. Should the public have somebody at the table at the negotiations? Should the press be there? Or should there at least be daily updates on all the details of the evolving negotiations and considerations so that the public has an opportunity to see that and have input into it before anything is finalized? Now, we know that it's said that the target date for, and we understand that the object here is to try to complete an agreement by the end of the year. Needless to say, that's barely more than 30 days. But we understand that the stadium completion date that is envisioned is sometime in 2017, or some 5 years from now. Should there be an opportunity for the public, the press, the guardians of the public, for the press, for the public itself, to see all of the details before a deal is finalized? And could there be, for example, a 60 to 90 day comment period, a cooling off period, if you will, an opportunity for public input after the deal is ready to be put in place, but it's not yet been put in place, so that it is not solidified in concrete, if you will. So these are among the things that we think are terribly important. For the public to have involvement and to have knowledge of, and we're so grateful to all of you for being here tonight to act as public emissaries to voice your questions. And again, our sincere thanks to Mr. Poe for being here, being part of this process. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Mr. Orr. Mr. Poe.
Thanks again to Common Cause for the opportunity to be involved with the program this evening. appreciate the opportunity to answer some of your questions. I can see now if I was put at the end, so I guess the flow of questions that will be coming this way at some point during the evening. It's probably best for me to kind of go back a little bit and put everything in some context that in 2010, the General Assembly and the governor of the state of Georgia signed a piece of legislation that extended the hotel motel tax. It's a 7% tax. Extended that to a period of 2050. There were conditions attached to the extension of that tax, namely that the tax could not be engaged unless there was a contractual relationship with an NFL team, namely the Falcons, for the development of a successor facility on the Georgia World Congress Center campus. And within that tax extension, what we're really talking about is 39.3% of that tax, which is a hotel motel tax, that it was the principal funding mechanism associated with a new stadium. So that's really what we're talking about in the context of the legislation. What the Falcons made known was that their interests lie in the development of a successor facility or stadium, new stadium, that would be their long-term solution for the next 30 plus years for the city of Atlanta and certainly for our campus. Absent a deal being put in place relative for a new stadium development or a project of this nature, the Atlanta Falcons contractual relationship with the authority would terminate in 2020 or at some point that the debt on the existing Georgia dome is retired, which could come as early as 2017. So from the perspective of what the authority was looking at relative to its long-term objectives, it wanted to ensure that it retained the Falcons on the campus of the Congress Center and within the city of Atlanta. So embarking on that journey of developing a business relationship with the Falcons was the charge that we were provided at the staff level. In the context of developing that relationship, we had certain key elements that were important to us to adhere to, and those were namely as follows. That in the structure of any deal with the Falcons, we wanted to ensure that we mitigated any capital risk that the state of Georgia would have relative to a new state. In other words, beyond what the hotel motel tax would support, 39.3% of the 7% tax, that would be the sole contribution made by the authority towards the development of a new stadium. Secondly, we wanted to mitigate the operational risk or exposure to the authority for a new facility. So within the structure of our relationship with the Falcons, we wanted to shed the operational cost exposure from the authority off to the Atlanta Falcons. Thirdly, in that the hotel motel tax is the only support that we as the authority could put on the table for developing this project. It was important that we ensure that we protected a group of events that had been developed within the dome that would move into that facility. And those events would include such things as the SEC Championship, the Chick-fil-A Bowl, the Kickoff Classic, Bank of America Classic, and a host of other events that would move into that new complex as a book of business, if you will. That became the third key element in the structure of our relationship. And then finally, from the long-term perspective, we wanted to ensure that the facility was maintained at a certain quality standard, and therefore the capital exposure associated with a future investments back into the facility were done at the expense of the Falcons, not of the state and not of the authority. Those are the four cornerstone pieces within the structure of the business relationship that we've embarked upon with the Falcons. In the context of the status of those negotiations, we are near completion of the term sheet. We have a couple of remaining items that we've got to close in off on, but the business structure of that relationship relative to the use of the hotel motel tax is near completion and hopeful that we would present to our board by the end of the year. In the context of what other governmental organizations may be involved with relative to the state, we have certainly, from both our point as well as the Falcons, engaged in dialogue with the City of Atlanta and with Fulton County so that they're fully apprised of the status of those negotiations as we've gone forward. What, if any, additional public funding support may be required or asked for is not something that we as the authority are putting on the table to those entities. They'll be subject to their own individual decisions based upon what they think might be appropriate, as in other public investments to support a stadium development, if there are any. To consider that this, the basic overall structure of this business relationship is that fully over two-thirds the cost of the project will come from the private sector. So if we're talking about a $1 billion project, it will be a state-owned asset of which approximately one-third the cost will, supported by the hotel motel tax, will be the public investment into that capital structure. The other two-thirds plus of the cost will come from the private sector, either through the Falcons, NFL, or stadium-related revenues that they would generate off the operation of that facility. So that forms the basic elements, if you will, of the business relationship that we're trying to gain closure on. Once a business term sheet is reached, then we'll move into a phase called a memorandum of understanding, which will form the basic definitive relationship between the authority and the Falcons for advancing a stadium project at this time. So the term sheet, which is posted on our website and available for others to look at and scrutinize, establishes the basic framework of support associated with the business relationship between the parties. So I'll hold off on this and respond to questions a little later on.
Okay. You guys can start. I want to make sure that everyone has a comment card or a question card. Pencil. Is there anyone that needs a comment card? Also, we have another elected official who just walked in, Atlanta City Council Member Cleta Winslow. Just wave your hand for us. Let's give her a round of applause. In the event that a new stadium is built, what can we do or what would we do with the old stadium? A lot of people have said that it's already successful, we don't need a new stadium. What would we do with the old one?
Well, since I'm not in charge, you know, my opinions are not that meaningful, but inevitably if a new stadium is built, the old one will be torn down because the feasibility of a dual stadium was examined in a master plan study several years ago. The economics of it simply don't make a lot of sense. Keep in mind, people think that stadiums are buildings to watch sporting events, and it's true that that does happen in it, but stadiums actually do one really critical thing above all else, which is they make money. They're machines for generating revenue. And the revenue that comes from a stadium accrues in greater proportion to the team franchise that is associated with the stadium than it does to almost any other individual actor. And in fact, most economic studies show that the average value of an NFL franchise doubles with the completion of a new stadium. Because the NFL shares revenue from licensing and broadcast agreements, this is one of the few non-sharing modes of revenue. So therefore, this is a critical aspect in this negotiation, which is why rehabbing an existing stadium would in fact be something that would be highly unlikely in this kind of scenario.
All right, and that question was for you because of your expertise in architecture. Thank you, Dr. Flowers. This question is for Mr. Orr. The process, has it been fair for the people? Do you think the folks out there, the taxpayers, have gotten a fair share when it comes to knowing about the entire process, what's going on, what's taking place behind closed doors?
Well, that's, of course, the direct concern of Common Cause Georgia, that what information is available to the public often is, as the saying goes, too little, too late. We don't feel that the public is apprised of frequently enough of the, as I said earlier, the evolving negotiations and how the terms are progressing. And for example, we often hear much said about economic impact from such statements. We know, for example, that by all reports, the projections that went with the stadium of Gwinnett County that the Gwinnett Braves, where they play, have not proven to be entirely correct. And that some of the benefits that were thought to be associated with that stadium have not, in fact, come to fruition. So that's one of the questions we have, is what economic impact has been developed. We know that there was a report that we gained access to today, which projects certain numbers, certain jobs, and the like. But what data, what assumptions went into that particular projection, what methodology was used, we think that's part of what needs to be revealed to the public and analyzed, is what can we expect in the way of the returns on that one-third public investment. So no, we think that more information is needed for the public, and it is needed in a timely way so that the public can review it, comment on it, and have meaningful input before there is any final deals from
it. Right. Mr. Poe, is there any talk behind closed doors that if indeed a stadium deal does not go through, that the Falcons would consider leaving the state of Georgia?
I would answer. The Falcons would have to answer that question. The Falcons have to answer the question of what decisions they would make.
But is there any talk behind closed doors?
No. I mean, our focus has been to try to get the best deal possible for the authority in the state of Georgia relative to a new stadium project. And I think it's one of the things I'd like to go back and just touch upon real quickly. If you consider that the Georgia Dome, which would be 100% public contribution, no contribution from the team that came into the existing facility, the annual economic impact of the Georgia Dome today is $269.2 million. And that is a study that we did on behalf by the state's economist, Georgia State University professor, that does our annual economic assessments both on the Georgia World Congress Center and the Georgia Dome. So $269 million, which includes all the events that go into the dome today, plus the Falcons that would move into a new facility. So if you took that just as the baseline, you're talking about at least that economic impact occurring on an annual basis within the city of Atlanta and the state of Georgia. One other thing to keep in mind is that translates in terms of tax revenues to the state at $13.1 million and to local governments in excess of $12 million annually off of the existing events that go into the Georgia Dome. I'm sorry to be calling on that.
Okay. All right, Mr. Pope, we'll start again with you on this question because it actually coincides with the question that I'm about to ask you. This is from Irma Gorham. Irma Gorham, if you could stand and wave your hand. She's over here to my right. Irma says, the Dome is a nice place and the location is great. Why should we even think of a new location?
That's probably a more challenged question to answer than some of the others. I think that if you go back to what I said initially, that the Falcons have made it known that their long-term future is vested in a new facility. That is where they believe their long-term best interest in. And if you consider that the Georgia Dome, at a point that a new facility could open in 2017, would be one of the older NFL stadiums within the NFL. Consider those two things, and as a basic fundamental premise. Your client, major client, an important component of the fabric of this city and this state, Falcons, plus the host of other events that we do in the Dome that are not married to the Dome, but certainly would want to be in the facility or in the state of Georgia, the city of Atlanta long term, a new facility begins to make some sense relative to the long term future growth and the economic value attached to those events. In terms of location, we have two possible sites that we're evaluating, one to the north, one to the south of the existing facility. Once that determination has been finalized and reached as part of the discussions with the Falcons, the dome would come down and be made available for some future redevelopment of the authority or part and parcel to the new stadium development over the life of the property of that activity.
Okay. This next question, anyone can tackle it. It comes from Baker Owens. Baker, if you could wave your hand. Can anyone give a definitive example of proof that the economics of the new stadium are worthless? And if you can, count the examples that show otherwise. Or if you can't, count the examples that show otherwise.
I can comment that the scholarly literature on the matter is fairly settled. Economic impact, not all economic impacts are equal. So, you know, for instance, if we all go out tonight and spend $100 at the Georgia Dome, the question about economic impact is twofold. One is, how much money do we spend at the Georgia Dome that we aren't then going to spend someplace else? So it's not necessarily new dollars. It's dollars that people would have spent on entertainment that they're now spending at one location. The follow-up question is, what happens to the money that gets spent at the Georgia Dome? If I spend $100 at a restaurant, it's much more like that $100 would be spent in the form of wages and supplies by the restaurant owner locally. So in fact, the re-spent dollars have a significant economic impact. NFL teams tend not to re-spend those dollars locally to the same extent. So economic impact is important, but not all economic impacts are equivalent. This deal that's being proposed is not as bad as many other municipalities have agreed to. Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, lots of places have in the recent past 10, 15 years agreed to much worse arrangements, in my opinion. However, I do not think that even at this level, they can be clearly stated that there is an unambiguous positive impact associated with this level of financing.
Give just a counter perspective. If you consider, a lot of what you said is exactly correct. When you consider spending associated by attendees, say, to a Falcons game, which is predominantly a local spend, whether it be at the Dome or some other location within the campus, what we quantify as the out-of-town visitor, both for those events that are Falcon-related or non-Falcon. You just set the Falcons to the side. Just put it over here and not look at the economic value attached to that. For the other non-Falcon events, in fiscal 2012, this most recent fiscal, $157 million in economic impact was generated off the non-Falcon events in the Georgia Dome alone, which generated an estimated sales tax to the state of Georgia almost $6.5 million. Sales tax generated, not counting the local sales tax that would be induced as a result. The economic value attached, and I don't think there are really many arguments. There are arguments relative to the methodology used and what sort of multipliers one would apply. But in our very conservative approach to this, we only use less than a 2.2 multiplier on our economic values, which is well below what other organizations would use. The direct new dollar spend on non-Falcon events is just under $100 million in the most recent fiscal year, 2012. If you aggregate that, since the point the dome was built, new dollars generated off the Georgia Dome today, just under $4.5 billion in economic impact for events not even associated with the Falcons. Totally out-of-town visitors that come into this state, in this city, to spend their dollars. That, to me, is a very significant investment and certainly a supportive reason for why a new facility and the value it brings to the state and the city on a long-term basis begins to talk volumes about where we as an authority look at the business structure and relationship in order to advance a development that mitigates our operating risk, mitigates our capital risk, protects the events we currently have in the facility, and ensure that the Falcons remain an important part of the city of Atlanta and the state of Georgia.
Okay. Anyone can also tackle this one as what a lot of people are concerned about, minority companies receiving contracts. How can they or will they be included, of course, if the new stadium is approved, and how?
In the term sheet, you can, in which you can look at. We address the MWD disadvantaged business program opportunities, both on the architecture but also the construction side. And that, the construction side is really where the most significant impact for disadvantaged businesses can occur. Both the Falcons and the Authority recognize that that's an important component and a building into the definitive documents that we have as the ultimate structure of the deal. However, I can go back historically and say within the funding agreements for the current Georgia Dome, there were disadvantaged business programs that we contracted with, and our funding contracts with the City of Atlanta and Fulton County spoke to very specifically relative to the level of participation for disadvantaged businesses within the creation of the Georgia Dome. And we see that same type of structure advancing going forward into a potential new state.
All right, that question was combined from Marcus Kedrick and Tom, so thank you so much for that. Anyone can also tackle this question. I hate this is turning into the Frank Poe show right here, but we haven't had a chance to really speak with him. This is from Steve McNeil, and any of you can tackle this as well. How can success be achieved and measured in connecting Castleberry Hill neighborhoods and other adjacent communities and making them stronger if indeed this deal goes through? How will it affect the community around here?
Propose a couple of things. One is I would say if you look at the existing Georgia Dome and you look at the infrastructure that is disconnected, transportation, mobility between neighborhoods on either side of it, one really important issue for me would be to ask how and in what fashion would we define success for a new city. And one thing I would say is it would be nice if success didn't replicate for the city, the Georgia Dome, in a different location in terms of its impact on its adjacent communities. Part of that process would require a sober assessment of effects, both good and bad. For instance, game day congestion and its impacts on neighboring churches is a major issue that we perhaps don't think about when we're not located there. So one thing I would say is that a very careful understanding of what a new stadium would do differently and better for the local community would be a very, very valuable place for the interested parties to negotiate about. And they should be doing it, I would suggest, now, but I think they can also do it farther down the road if there is a political will and public pressure for that to happen. I think these are all parties who are interested in seeing this structure succeed. And I think to the extent it could be distinct from other cities in the publicly funded study and what it does better and more equitably would actually be a real model for the Falcons, for Arthur Blank, and for the City of Atlanta to pursue.
Let me follow up on that just a little bit. I think it's fair to say that that kind of question is at the heart of what Common Cause Georgia thinks will be assisted and answered better by greater public disclosure, including on the final plan. For example, if it is released to the public in a full fashion, what infrastructure changes there will be, what streets may be closed, what traffic may be diverted, the impact on surrounding communities. If that is released to the public in a full manner early enough for people in those communities to see them, to know what it's going to do and have the opportunity for input, that's the kind of public involvement and input that is needed here. In that regard, let me just allude to Mr. Pope directly. Something more recent on this, and I certainly invite you to do so. But I'm looking at this draft of October 21 term sheet, and maybe something more recent than that, so I stand to be corrected. But I notice, for example, I'm looking at page 7 now, that the World Congress Center Authority may cooperate reasonably with the stadium company. That's the Falcons affiliate, as I understand it, that will be a part of. And Falcons in pursuing other possible governmental funding sources with respect to such off-site infrastructure as may be required by applicable law, code, regulation, or ordinance, and public safety and welfare considerations and or requirements. Well, and as I say, the term sheet in many places is just that, the term sheet, and it has to be general, and we appreciate that. But disclosing that may not be enough before a final deal is struck to give the public the kind of meaningful information needs to determine what neighborhood impact will be, what infrastructure changes there will be, and what those other governmental sources are that are going to be, that are alluded to here as possibly being relied upon to assist in some of those infrastructure changes. And to the extent that's going to fall on the city of Atlanta or other governmental entities, we think that public knowledge, awareness, input needs to be known if there's going to be a cost factor associated with local governments. How is that cost going to be borne? Where is that money going to come from? Is it from existing budgeting items? Is it going to be additional revenue? That is taxes. And that's the kind of thing that we think that more information would be helpful to all concerned, including the affected community.
This question is pretty simple from Mr. John Michael. Will it help get the Super Bowl back in Atlanta?
I have no idea.
That they have it back in line for the team, so that's a myth.
I have no earthly idea whether it would help get us another Super Bowl or not at this point. Let me go back to something that was mentioned here in terms of engagement. I got here in April of 2010 from Dallas, and within the first year, I embarked on an effort to engage with the two principal communities, Castleberry Hills more recently, but within the Chattanooga and Vine City, both with the neighborhood associations as well as with the UL planning unit for English Avenue and Vine City. All with the intended purpose of engaging in that sort of public dialogue with those stakeholders that can be affected the most by stadium development. More recently with Castleberry Hills, because of some other issues that they're experiencing as well with the current operation of the stadium, we've had the opportunity to at least start a dialogue with Castleberry Hills in terms of better understanding what their concerns are. Not just on the new stadium, but with our existing operation as well. So we've got twofold opportunities there. So I think to suggest that somehow we're not engaged in public conversation at the most effective level is a bit disingenuous. I think the second thing that I would point out is that at such point in time that there are infrastructure impacts of which we don't know, we haven't quantified in total what those may be or what they might want to look like, because it's site dependent. Those are going to be fully vetted to the city council and in Fulton County to the extent that they have impacts or requests are made for their consideration. And the last time I looked, those were all public forums, all of which are debated in a public environment in an arena. And therefore, public input would be a component part of that discussion. So we're not doing anything behind closed doors, making commitments that certain things would happen, that we as an authority would be doing certain things, but only recognizing in the context of the term sheet that there may be those situations that arise in which the city and the county would need to be engaged in that conversation and had that opportunity to make determinations on their own relative to what level, if any, involvement they would want to have with any type of potential request. And I would say one last thing, that there is no design for the facility at this point. We haven't even selected the architect that might be involved with the project. A lot of what you're talking about is highly speculative at best, and only within the term sheet recognizing that those potentials may exist, but you can't quantify something that you don't know. And you can't know it until you get to a point where, hey, you've got a deal that you can work with on the team. And secondly, you've got an architect that starts designing a facility that would start identifying what, if any, of those possible issues may be. And then you take it into public forum to the city, to the county, and you lay out your case. And the city and the county make those determinations.
But Daryl Paddock with the West Atlanta Watershed Alliance wants to know how the stadium will deal with its stormwater and other environmental impacts. Have you guys talked about that or had any discussion?
That was, I guess, one of the first meetings I was able to attend in English Avenue in Vine City. It was pointed out some of the prior issues associated with the Georgia Dome in terms of stormwater runoff and flooding that the Dome may be an approximate cost to, or the development may be an approximate cost to. I would have to put my whole head in a hole to not have heard some of those concerns and issues voiced by the neighborhood. So certainly we're sensitive to it, we understand it. We certainly don't want to replicate anything that would have that type of impact or any other impact. And as I said, until you get to a point that you've got a business deal that you can work with, and then select the architect to start the design, and then you start looking at those types of issues and impact and find the solution to those problems. Thank you.
Anybody can answer this question. How can the Gulch project work with the new proposed stadium? This question is coming from Deborah Scott.
We're aware of the Gulch, the project there, but our decisions relative to the stadium are not being done in the context of that development. We're certainly will respect whatever happens, but until that project becomes real, this could be very difficult for us to be planning something for something native. And until we get this still about this, it would be foolhardy for us to plan something until we've got an understanding that we can do a business term, have a business relationship for the state.
This is a little bit about the citizens as far as taking part in this negotiation process. Is there a board of just normal citizens, taxpayers, and is the party having a fair opportunity to have their voices heard? Who are the influences of that?
Well, if I understand the question correctly, there's not any citizen board that is voting and addressing the needs of work. There's not any one entity or board that represents the public that is present in these negotiations or has even access to negotiations as they progress.
Can you tell us why?
Good question.
Can you tell us why?
Well, I suppose one question would be what we want, who would we want to constitute that board, how would it be composed, but that's what Common Cause Georgia stands for and is attempting to be in this process is a public supported entity that is convening a forum like this and is trying to do what we can to develop even more openness in the process. So to that extent, that's what Common Cause Georgia is trying to do here, is to act as a citizen advocacy group to open the process up even more. We say very briefly in that regard that we appreciate the fact that after a deal is finalized, that there will be, I'm sure, discussions, meetings, and the like between the Georgia World Congress Center Authority and local governments and the like. I think our concern is that if certain consequences of decisions that are being made now are virtually irreversible, and that is going to impose certain alterations to the infrastructure, things that will affect the surrounding communities in ways that are really unavoidable by that point in time. Have the local communities had enough advance notice of that to be heard before those things are put in place that are going to dictate some of those subsequent developments?
This question is for Mr. Poe, coming from Councilmember Ivory Young. NFL made $150 million available to Dallas for their stadium. Will the NFL support the Falcons financially?
The answer is probably it will, because they've got a new, the Falcons have an advance and official request, and they can't do so until there's an agreement in place that would allow for them to do so. But the most recent adjustments within the NFL program to support stadium developments provides up to, I believe, $200 million in and loans and grants that would be available to the team to use in support of the stadium. That's why I said from the outset that with over two-thirds of the value of $1 billion stadium coming from the private sector, it's really composed of three things: the Falcons, the NFL, as well as stadium generated revenue. So that's how that funding piece would be $700+ million would be structured.
Okay.
Have patience with me, folks. Some of the writing is incredible up here. You guys are still my friends.
We are working with you.
This question is from Ronnie Mosley. What developments that were planned for the community when building the current building have been completed? What community developments?
So I guess what were some of the benefits from the current stadium and the area surrounding? Anybody know?
Zero.
The only thing I'm aware of initially constructed was an $8 million contribution that came from the Georgia World Congress Center that went into the development authority for the, and I probably don't have the name of the authority just correct, but about $8 million was provided by the Congress Center towards that development group that leveraged, I believe, about $100 million in overall development. And that goes back to a report that was done in 2001, I believe. So there was how we did not engage in deciding how those funds would be spent. We allowed it to be driven by the authority that, for which the funding was provided. So how they leveraged that, how they used the funds to better the community would be best directed back.
Can't hear you, Mr. Paul. Could you repeat that, please?
I'm just saying, which part do you want me to repeat?
Just the last.
Okay. I don't know exactly how, I can't give you the exact information because the last report I saw was back in 2001. But it was certainly a report from the authority that received the funds that reflected how those funds were utilized and leveraged for other investments within the community.
Okay. Thank you. This is the last question, and then we'll go ahead and turn it over to William. With the proposed site, what's the plan? Plan, if any, to connect MARTA to the new stadium?
Have you guys talked about the transportation center?
Well, I mean, that certainly is a key component within the overall site decisions is access to MARTA. Certainly a north side decision would make it more challenged just because of distances. South side decision has its own constraining issues, but is more proximate to MARTA. So within the north side decision is where the state of development would be landed on, then certainly architecturally would have to be treated on making sure there was the right type of connectivity between MARTA and the new stadium development. South side decision, it would be a totally different solution, but certainly one that is probably a little bit easier to deal with.
Okay. Now we'll have 90 seconds of closing remarks. I'll start with you on Dr. Flowers.
I'll close by saying this, the Georgia World Congress Center, the Falcons, and the political leaders involved are making this decision within the political and cultural milieu of the city of Atlanta. And to that extent, it's not as if they're breaking the rules. They're following the existing rules. What I would suggest to you is that the process that entails allows for a project of this size to get very, very far with almost no meaningful public scrutiny. And from any political or political economic perspective, that would be at best undemocratic and at worst anti-democratic. And as a result, it's not a question of assessing the goodwill and good faith of the individual actors who are doing what the system allows them to do. The questions we might have are, in what fashion would we like to see this existing system changed so that projects of this nature actually follow a different line of approval? And to that extent, the work of, I think, Georgia Common Cause is critical, but I think it's also critical that we begin to ask of our local elected political leaders how and in what fashion these kinds of projects could be handled in the future differently and better.
Well, on behalf of Common Cause Georgia, let me again forward, and the kind of input that's needed from people who will be most affected by this. So Common Cause Georgia Service appreciates your involvement. And I think we would just reiterate our call that the negotiations be opened up in a way which will allow public representatives and the press to be more present and more involved as negotiations progress on a day-to-day basis. And we would hope that there would be an opportunity when a deal has been arrived at, but before it is etched in stone, before it's final, for as many of those details as possible to be revealed to the public, and for there to be a public comment period where all manner of people can see what is going to be done before it's done, and can have the opportunity for input, for questioning. You know, I told using during an interview today, it reminds me of something Ralph Waldo Emerson said. He said, you know, all too often people question the masses. Someone questions the masses. What are the masses? Well, Emerson had great faith in the masses, as he said, had great faith in the common sense of the public to see things that those directly involved in negotiations may not recognize as far as impact on the community, impact on the people who live and work in close proximity to what's going to happen there. So we call for that to be greater publicized in the bulletin so there can be more comment before anything is final, and right. for a cooling off period where the public can see exactly what's going to transpire before it does, so there's an opportunity for main public input. Thank right. you.
Well, again, the Common Cause, thanks for the opportunity to share this evening with you. As a citizen of the city of Atlanta and a taxpayer within the city of Atlanta, I'm a member of that public that you speak about. So I carry within our discussions and negotiations with the Falcons that perspective that whatever we do has an impact on all of us as citizens within this city. And I believe, contrary to some of the comments made, that our process of access to information, the availability of the press to participate in our committee meetings, our board meetings, is always open. The press makes those choices on what they want to participate in or not participate in. We make the information available. It's posted on our website of all the studies we've done, our most recent term sheets, all the elements that we're in the process of developing. And rest assured, there's not a day goes by that I don't hear from some member of the public relative to the project and relative to this program. And I would want to leave this one piece with you as you leave out this evening. We have four basic elements. Mitigate the risk to the state, shift the operational burden and capital costs to the Falcons, protect the events that enjoy the dome and enjoy being in the city for the future, and ensure that the long-term viability of the stadium is advanced through not state dollars, but through the dollars from the Falcons and the private entity using that facility. And last but not least, it is a public-private partnership. Over two-thirds of the value of this project is coming from private sector. One-third or less is coming from the public sector. The public sector will own a billion-dollar asset at the end of the day for less than 30 cents on the dollar and ensure that the $200+ million of annual economic impact that the current facility generates continues on for the next 30 to 35 years within the city of Atlanta and the state of Georgia. And with that, I'll close, and thanks for the opportunity to be here.
All right, well, let's give it a round of applause.
I encourage you personally to come up and give these guys email information or contacts. Also, the city and state leaders who are also at the audience, they are working for you. So take advantage of this opportunity to have your voices on here. This time I'll turn it over to William. Thank you for having me, folks. Enjoy your evening.
Thank you very much for your great leadership tonight. We got about four questions of the same topic that I did want to clarify, and those were about having a Falcons representative participate in the forum. So I did want to let you know that they were invited and declined the opportunity. So we did make that outreach
and hope that there was a representative participant made in that, but since we had so many questions, I didn't want to clarify that was extended and unfortunately declined. Real quick, if you'll give me patience for a commercial, I also want to thank our board members who are here tonight to help us lead our organization and allow us to do these things. Our board chair, John Sintons, right over there. Board member, Joy Kramer. And of course, Wyc Orr. And then Professor Greg Hall, who welcomes you tonight. I'll close with this. Yeah, please give him a round of applause. Oh, and I'm sorry, and Terry Taylor. See, he's not in the line of sight. He needs to help with that. So Mr. Terry Taylor, thank you very much. And just to let you know, we're not the most tech-savvy organization. Our laptop died, so we don't have this information up here, but I wanted to share with you a new group called Open Atlanta, and their website is openatlanta.com, is doing a text poll for us on the new stadium. So if you send a text to the number 404-850-8869, if you text stadium to that, it will send you three text questions that you can answer and take that poll. Again, it's openatlanta.com, and you text to 404-850-8869, and that'll be open through December 6th, and then we'll collect and disseminate the results of that. Finally, thank you all for being here. If you'll give yourselves a hand, we'll close the evening with that.
Make a phone call.